Attention, students of ICSE Class 9 and 10 and Intermediate First Year. Do subscribe to Study with Sudhir YouTube channel where we cover English Literature, History, Civics, Geography, Biology and English Grammar and many important motivational videos too. Don't forget to click on the bell icon so that you can get regular updates.
Hello and welcome to Study with Sudhir, your digital classroom. Today, after a lot of requests from a large number of students, we are going to be looking at Chief Seattle Speech, which is part of the ICSE Class 9 and Class 10 syllabus in English Literature. This is the Chief Seattle Speech, but before we get into that, we'll be doing it in two parts, mainly because it's a slightly complicated story. It's a very fascinating story, but nevertheless a bit complicated. But before we get into it, we need to know what is the context in which this speech was actually delivered and what it has what has happened over the years. Now, Chief Seattle, who lived from 1786 till 1866, was a public leader and the chief of the Native American, that is the Red Indian, Suquamish, I'll spell it out, S-U-Q-A-M-I-S-H, and the Duwamish, D-U-W-A-M-I-S-H tribes. So he was the leader of these two tribes of Red Indians, the Chief Seattle. Now, in fact, the American city Seattle was subsequently named after him. So you can imagine the impact that he had on American way of life and American politics. Now, he's particularly known for this speech that he delivered, okay, sometime in 1854. Okay, about 12 years before he passed away, this speech that he delivered, sometimes it's also referred to as the letter. Okay, now this speech, why was this speech delivered is something which you need to know, and this we will need to include in many or any question that comes, any answer that you write on a question relating to Chief Seattle. Now, the speech was a response to the American government, to the US government's land treaty to buy the native lands. And that was proposed by a person called Isaac Stevens, I-S-A-A-C, Stevens, S-T-E-V-E-N-S, the governor of Washington. Okay, so this was the politics of that time, that he had proposed his land treaty, and this was the letter or oblique speech delivered by the Chief Seattle. Now, the Seattle speech, why is it so important? Is that because it is regarded as a rather powerful plea, a request for the rights of the Native Americans, in this case the Red Indians, and also for respecting the environmental values. And why it's so significant, why is something like this included in your syllabus? Because you may think that this is of another era, of another country, and really has no basic cultural affinity. I mean, we can't really relate to it. On the contrary, what has happened in this particular case is actually happening in different parts of the globe, including in India. Haven't you heard instances of powerful men, powerful political parties, political powerful politicians, powerful corporates trying to grab a piece of land that may be occupied by tribals? This is happening to a large extent in states like Chhattisgarh, in states like Odisha, which are mineral-rich territories. So that happens quite often in different parts, in different forms. So what is happening now in the 19th century, in 1854, when this speech was delivered, has relevance for all of us, for any citizen in any part of the world, which is why it is so relevant, and that's why it's been included in the syllabus. Now, basically, the Chief Seattle, he criticizes in this particular speech, oblique letter, he criticizes the white man's obsession with occupying land which he actually belongs to someone else, and basically it kind of conveys a very imperialistic kind of an attitude. Okay, it conveys a very imperialistic kind of an attitude and their way of development while not taking enough care about safeguarding the environment. And that is again very relevant today, because we are hearing people talking about climate change, about global warming. Why is it all taking place? Essentially because of the kind of policies that are being adopted and followed by different countries without actually taking care about the carbon footprint, about the kind of degradation and the damage to the environment that is taking place at the same time. Okay. In fact, this particular speech is seen as one of the earliest instances, as one of the earliest instances of someone so powerful, someone at least in a position of power to an extent, talking about the impact, the negative impact on the environment and the entire ecological balance. Okay. Now, in this particular speech, he also warns against the progress made by the Western civilization, in this case, the white men. And basically, he advocates the need for protection of the environment and the protection of nature. That is one of the running themes in this particular speech, which is why, as I said, over the years, this particular Chief Seattle speech is kind of widely praised, it's acclaimed, and basically seen as very relevant to the world, to the times that we live in at this point in time. Now, the interesting part is that he had delivered the speech not in English. He had delivered the speech in his native language, and that native language is called Lushoot Seat. I hope I'm pronouncing it correct. Lushootseed. Lushoot Seat. That is the native language of the Red Indians in which the speech was initially, was actually delivered. And subsequently over the years, it has been translated, a bit of rewriting has been done by several authors. So it has passed down from generation to generation. So which is why the authenticity of the original text is not quite established. You know, what we are reading now, we do not know whether it is word to word translation of what Chief Seattle had actually said at that point in time in 1854, because over the years, many translations and many rewritings have actually taken place. The oldest available record of this document is by Henry A. Smith. Henry A. Smith's transcript, and that's what you're reading now. And that was published in the Seattle Sunday Star in 1887. That also a good, 23 years after the speech was delivered. So this is what we are reading now. But which is why there are some critics. There are some critics who see what is written in Henry Smith's transcript, translation, as a little more flowery kind of a prose as compared to what Seattle's original speech may well have been. Okay, but we'll obviously go by what Henry Smith's translation is, because that's essentially what we have. But before we get on to the actual text of the Chief Seattle's speech, it was known as the Chief Seattle's Treaty Oration of 1854. Treaty Oration. Oration essentially means, again, oratory means, you know, the skill of speaking, public speaking. Now, there are essentially five themes that actually run in this particular speech, which you should be familiar with. One, of course, is the attachment of Red Indians to their land. Okay, please note it down. Of course, I hope you also have your textbook before you, because when we go through it, I would kind of reckon that you should be making your underlining the keywords and also making your notes on a separate notebook. Red Indians' attachment to their land. That is one of the first themes of this particular speech, oblique letter, oblique text. Number two, the supremacy of the white man. That's another thing which is a running theme through this speech. Third is the focus on the environmental and ecological sustainability. Okay. Fourth is the difference in the worldview of whites and the Red Indians. The native tribes, that is the Red Indians and the white men of America. How differently they look at the same world. That is another running theme. And finally, the concept of God, very important. The concept of God, how the God of Red Indians, according to Chief Seattle, actually differs from the God, the Christian God of the whites. That is the fifth theme that runs through this particular speech. So let's start with the speech. We will cover a part of the speech in part one, video analysis. Then in second part, we'll go through the rest of it. Okay. We start. I mean, obviously, as I said, the speech is a response to Governor Isaac Stevens' proposal to acquire the land of the Red Indians. So it is in response to that letter that the Chief Seattle is actually making his speech, this speech to his people. Yonder sky that has wept tears of compassion upon my people for centuries untold, and which to us appears changeless and eternal, may change. Okay, now what is meant by I mean, what does this exactly mean? Now, what he is doing is that at the very beginning of this speech, Chief Seattle is expressing his concern for the environmental degradation and its impact upon human civilization. Okay, upon human civilization. Yonder sky refers to the far away distant sky. Okay, now according to him, yonder sky that has wept tears of compassion upon my people for centuries untold. You know, the sky which has kind of blessed my land and which to us appears changeless and eternal. You know, we always thought that what we are seeing here is absolutely something which will stay on forever. May actually change, comma, may change. That's a very important, the way he must have taken a pause and then said, may change. You know, so you could, what I would really request you to do is to imagine someone, you know, in a tribal costume actually delivering this kind of a fantastic speech. That is the kind of imagination, if you do, you'd be able to understand and appreciate this that much better. So basically what he says when he's referring to a phrase like for centuries untold, what he's basically saying is that nature has sympathized with his people, with his tribe of Red Indians for many centuries till now. Nature has been a great sympathizer and it has given them everything to live on this earth, but today is fair. Mark these words, and this is generally one of the sentences which should come. Today is fair, tomorrow it may be overcast with clouds. Okay, so the Chief Seattle feels that while things are fine at this point in time as he speaks, tomorrow the scenario may well change. Because the chief in Washington obviously wishes to buy their land with, that's his desire. So that may actually change a lot of the present status quo. So he fears that though this condition seems to be eternal and changeless, it may ultimately change. Human civilization, and I mean the running theme which will come later on, is that human civilization may face great trouble in future if we don't respect the environment. Okay, today is fair, tomorrow may be overcast with clouds. So it's almost a sense of, as though something bad is going to happen, something negative as far as the Red Indians are concerned is going to happen. Tomorrow it may be overcast with clouds. Overcast with clouds referring to, again, something which is not exactly very, very positive. Okay, whatever Seattle says, the great chief at Washington can rely upon with as much certainty as he can upon the return of the sun or the season. So what he's saying is that when I say something, the great chief in Washington can rely on it. You know, what I say is a word given and he can expect that it will be followed to the last alphabet. With as much certainty as he can rely on the return of the sun, because the return of the sun, it rises in the east, sets in the west at a particular time. So that is given certain. Similarly, seasons, winter will come November, summers will be in the after April, May, June. So, you know, there is something certain about the way the sun rises and sets, about the change of the seasons. So similarly, his word is also carrying that much of certainty is what the Chief Seattle says. The white chief says that the big chief at Washington sends us greetings of friendship and goodwill. This is kind of him, for we know that he has little need of our friendship in return. His people are many. They are like the grass that covers vast prairies. So he says that he's also, what these lines convey is that Seattle is very conscious of his diminished stature, you know, in terms of prowess at this point in time. He knows that he cannot put up a fight to the powerful white men in America, in Washington. So, which is why you look at his language. The big chief at Washington sends us greetings of friendship and goodwill. This is kind of him, you know. So it's almost like he understands that he has to kowtow to them. You know, he can't really put up any kind of resistance vis-a-vis the people in Washington. For we know he has little need of a friendship in return. I mean, he can use his military to kind of make us submit to him. So he doesn't really need to be friends with us, despite which he's actually extending a hand of friendship. So that is kind of him. His people are many. What is left unsaid is that we are not that many in number. They are like the grass that covers vast prairies. So vast prairies is open areas of grassland which is found in North America. Okay, open areas of grassland. So essentially conveying the grass conveying the number of people that are there. My people are few. You know, so he's making that contrast very, very clear. They resemble the scattering trees of a storm-swept plain. Again, you know, when the storm sweeps the plains, you know, the scattered trees which are all over the place. The great and I presume good. So he's saying he's great and I also think he would be good. White chief sends us word that he wishes to buy our land but is willing to allow us enough to live comfortably. So he's using the word good for him. He's already used the word great. And he says that he wants to buy our land but is willing to allow us enough to live comfortably. You know, according to the white man, what would be needed for us to live comfortably, he's willing to allow us that. Okay, so it is, you know, immediately that the equation between the white men and the red Indians is very clearly established, and the chief Seattle is seems to be very conscious of that equation. This indeed appears just, even generous, for the red man no longer has rights for that he need respect, and the offer may be wise also, as we are no longer in need for an extensive country. Two important points that Seattle is making out here, that this actually is a very generous kind of an offer by the white man from Washington, because the red tribes no longer have rights which he need to respect. He can actually ride roughshod over us, but he's not doing that. On the contrary, he's respecting what we need. Okay, that's one. So therefore, he calls the offer as wise. Also, number two, because the number are much less, they are no longer in need for such a big, huge tracts of land, such a big country. That's another point that Seattle is making to his people. Okay, so basically it says that it is kind that the great chief has extended the hand of friendship to the red Indians, as he is in little need for their help or friendship. The red Indians cannot really offer much to the whites except for giving their land. His people are powerful as compared to them. The proposition therefore seems to be just, kind and generous, as the red men really now have no rights, which Seattle is kind of very conscious about. He needs little of the speaker's friendship because his people are strong and powerful than red Indians in terms of martial strength and power. Okay, so what is the comparison made in this paragraph could be one of the questions that could be asked. So I hope you have understood the kind of contrast that he's making between his men and the whites. Okay, that is one thing. Then we come to the next. Just to kind of go through it so that you understand this much more thoroughly. The governor has arrived with the proposal and the message of friendship from the big chief. That is we are presuming that he's referring to the president of the United States of America. Seattle says that it's kind of them to offer their natives their goodwill and friendship because he knows that otherwise the government really, really has no need for the natives' friendship and goodwill in return. He speaks about the deplorable conditions of his people. Okay, that comes in the next paragraph. There was a time when our people covered the land as the waves of a wind-ruffled sea cover its shell-paved floor. Okay, so now notice the contrast. Now, earlier in the first paragraph, he says, my people are few. But at one point in time, the red Indians were as many as the waves of a wind-ruffled sea covering its shell paved floor. So my advice to you would be is that when you are writing this kind of a contrast between the red Indians and the white men, please use this kind of phrases from the text itself. That will make your answer look that much better. But that time long since passed away with the greatness of tribes that are now but a mournful memory. But that time has passed now, and what remains now is a mournful memory. Mournful as in you kind of feel bad about what the fact that is now just a memory. It is no longer present in this present moment. I will not dwell on nor mourn over our untimely decay. Suddenly in the next paragraph, though he has used the phrase mournful memory, he says that, but I will not mourn over this kind of a decay of, you know, our generation, that we are now very few in number as compared to the times when we were like the waves of a wind-ruffled sea, you know, conveying a larger number. Nor reproach my pale-faced brothers, you know. So basically he says that I will no longer scold the people who are responsible for this present position. Okay, with hastening it, as we too may have been somewhat to blame. So what does it convey? One, it conveys extreme maturity on part of the Chief Seattle, that he's very mature and understanding of what were the circumstances and the reasons that led to this kind of a present position. One. Number two, he also realizes that we ourselves may have had to be blamed for bringing situations, the situation to such a pass, that it is, the situation is such that we are few in number, so we ourselves may have to blame. Number three, he says that despite that, I will not scold the people who were responsible for it. He says, my pale-faced brothers, I will not kind of reproach them. I will not kind of berate them for their role in kind of bringing about the present situation. Youth is impulsive. When our young men grow angry at some real or imaginary wrong and disfigure their faces with black paint, it denotes that their hearts are black and that they are often cruel and relentless, and our old men and old women are unable to restrain them. Thus, it has ever been. Youth is impulsive. Again, a very pertinent point that he's making, that youth often kind of takes decisions or indulges in action without actually giving it much thought, that they turn violent and indulge in some kind of revengeful act when the white men try to push them, and they thought at that point in time that it will result in some kind of gains, and they grow angry. And he says that they grew angry both at real wrongs as well as at imaginary wrongs, you know, things that may not have been the case, yet they grew angry. So it kind of also conveys a sense that they may also have committed some wrong, and also reflect some kind of a basic sense of distrust between the whites and the red Indians. And he says, when they disfigure their faces with black paint, this is important, he says that it also denotes that their hearts are black. You know, the face is a reflection of what is there inside your heart. So when you are disfiguring your faces with black paint, you're also conveying what is inside your heart, that your heart is also black, you know, to convey negative emotions, that they are often cruel and relentless, and that old men and old women are unable to restrain them, you know, that they are not able to be controlled by the elders in the red Indian tribes. Thus it has ever been. Thus it was when the white man began to push our forefathers ever westward. So he's talking about the historical facts that, you know, when the white men were actually trying to make inroads. But let us hope that the hostilities between us may never return. We would have everything to lose and nothing to gain. Revenge by young men is considered gain. You know, when we take revenge by young men, it's considered heroic. It's considered courageous. So therefore, they think that you're actually making some kind of gains, even at the cost of their own lives, even though they may get killed themselves. But old men who stay at home in times of war, and mothers who have sons to lose, they know better. So he's reflecting extreme maturity when he's actually delivering this speech. And he's talking about the fact that what it conveys, it conveys two things. One, his wisdom. Number two, that he's peace loving, and he kind of understands the futility of war, the extreme futility of war, that war actually does not gain anything, even though revenge by young men is considered gainful. But looking at the situation in which the Red Indians find themselves at this point in time, he says that people should realize that at the end of the day, it did not really result in any significant gains. Okay. Now, he talks about the good father in Washington once again. So the second time he's using the adjective good for the person in Washington. For I presume he's now our father as well as yours. So now he says that he's almost now going to be our Mai Bap as well. You know, he's going to be our guardian angel, because we are going to now be the subjects of this particular country. I say, sends us word that if we do as he desires, he will protect us. So he has conveyed it to them, to Chief Seattle, that if the Red Indian tribes do as he desires, he will kind of take care of their interests. His brave warriors will be to us a bristling wall of strength, and his wonderful ships of war will fill our harbors, so that our ancient enemies far to the northward, the Haidas and the Tsimsheans, will cease to frighten our women, child and old men. So he says that we will be protected by the armed forces of America as well against our traditional enemies, who he mentions, the Haidas and the Tsimsheans. Then in reality, he will be our father. And we his children. So he says, so that will mean that, you know, he'll be our father and we'll be his children, like his subjects. But can that ever be? You see, the whole tone and tenor of the speech is also very rhetorical. You know, I mean, that's a classical way people deliver speeches, you know. It's also a way of interacting with and keeping the audience engaged with what you are saying. You know, he'll be our father and we'll be his children. But can that ever be? He's also asking a question, you know, and he's also trying to make the people who are listening to him think, can that ever be? Your God is not our God. Underline this sentence. This is a very important phrase, sentence from this particular speech. Your God is not our God. Your God loves your people and hates mine. He's making a very important point out here. And that's followed by an exclamation mark. He folds his strong protecting arms lovingly about the pale face and leads him by the hand as a father leads an infant son. So he says that, you know, your God actually takes very good care of the whites. Pale face. He takes very good care of the whites and leads them as though if it's a father leading an infant son. But he doesn't do that with us red Indians. But he has forsaken his red children if they really are his. You know, our God, the Great Spirit. And then he goes on to make a distinction between their God and our God. What I spoke about the concept of God being one of the main themes of this particular speech. Your God makes the people wax stronger every day. Soon they will fill all the land. Our people are ebbing away like a rapidly receding tide that will never return. That will never return. The white man's God cannot love our people or he would protect them. They seem to be orphans who can look nowhere for help. How then can we be brothers? So he's making all these points. He's making the distinction, and I would want you to kind of make all these points 1, 2, 3, 4 so that you can all actually put it down in points as to what is the distinction that he makes between their God and his God. Okay, so this is one of the main themes of this particular speech, which is very, very important for you. Okay. How can your God become our God and renew our prosperity and awaken in us dreams of returning greatness? If we have a common heavenly Father, if we had the same God, he must be partial. He must be partial, for he came to his pale-faced children. He came to look only after the white children. We never saw him. We never saw him. He gave you laws, but he had no word for his red children, whose teeming multitudes once filled this vast continent as stars filled the firmament. Earlier, the reference was to the waves of the sea. Now it is to the stars in the sky. No, we are two distinct races with separate origins and separate destinies. There is little in common between us. This paragraph is the most important paragraph along with the first paragraph. This paragraph is the most important paragraph in the Chief Seattle speech. So you need to know the nuances which he's making, especially the distinction between his God and the white man's God, and saying that no, there is nothing in common between us. It's extremely, extremely significant. Okay, just to kind of do a quick analysis. Okay, basically, what in a nutshell, it means that the white people have received all the love and affection and care of their God. But the red Indians, the red tribes, the tribal people have been at the same time deprived of the love of this particular God. You know, the protection, the guidance, the love and affection of this God. And so that is the distinction he makes. And he says it very clearly that your God is not our God. And there is really nothing in common between you people and the red Indians. Okay. So that is the distinction that he is making. So the God of white people loved his people, that is the white men, and did not really care for the tribal people, which is the red Indians. That he seems to have forsaken them is the argument put forth by the Chief Seattle. Okay, so that is as far as this particular paragraph is concerned. Let's do one more paragraph and then we will go to the part two of this particular Chief Seattle speech. To us, the ashes of our ancestors are sacred and their resting place is hallowed ground. You wander far from the graves of your ancestors and seemingly without regret. Your religion was written upon tablets of stone by the iron finger of God so that you could not forget. Okay. So, what is it specifically speaking about here? That every part of their soil, when he's referring to the phrase hallowed ground, he basically means to say that every part of their soil, of their land, is sacred for them. Okay. And that is why he refers to them as hallowed ground. Okay. Then the second is the tablets of stone, which he's referring to. It basically refers to the Ten Commandments. In Christianity, the Ten Commandments which are written on stone tablets. Stone tablets, that is the reference to the tablets of stone. By the iron finger of your God. Now that is referring to the Ten Commandments in Christianity, which are written on stone tablets by God. The iron fingers refer to the fingers of God. Okay, the red man could never comprehend or remember it. So the red man is not able to be, you know, understand what is this whole Ten Commandments all about. Our religion is in the traditions of the ancestors, the dreams of our old men given to them in solemn hours by the night of the Great Spirit. So the way the whole concept of God itself, just like there's a world of difference between Hinduism and Christianity, Hinduism and Islam. Similarly, the Chief Seattle is making a distinction between the way Christianity is followed, practiced and followed by the white men and the kind of God that red Indians, the tribes believe in. And he says that our religion is in the traditions of the ancestors, the dreams of the old men given to them in solemn hours of the night by the Great Spirit and the visions of our sachems, and is written in the hearts of the people. What he's basically saying is that the white men believed in the institution of Christianity. Okay, where religion was written upon tablets of stone by iron fingers, suggesting the Ten Commandments which the Christians follow. Now, as opposed to that, as against those Ten Commandments, the Red Indians followed their ancestors' spirits. You know, the people who had passed away, and they believed that their spirits still lived around their land which they inhabited. And they never leave their land. The spirits of their ancestors never leave their land even after they were no more. And after they had passed away, after they were dead, they guided the present generations through their trials and tribulations, through their life and times, to the on the right path of action, on the correct path of action, which they needed to follow, which essentially meant what? To respect nature, to love nature, to take care of the environment, so that you leave, kind of keep the mankind in a very happy space. So what is the difference in the worldview of the whites and the red Indians, that the other theme that I spoke about? It basically speaks about the contrast between them, that while they follow the Ten Commandments in Christianity, here they are guided by the spirits of their ancestors, which continue to be on their land to guide them to respect environment and respect nature even after they were no more. So these are some of the themes that we are talking about. So basically, the native red Indians living closer to the nature, loving the beautiful aspects of nature and understanding the importance of maintaining them. This land which now the white man covets, he's looking to occupy this land. So he's also talking, he's bringing it slowly, talking about the concept of God, environment, and talking about the importance of land which now will be taken over by the white. So he tries to make them understand how important this particular land is to the red Indians, because it is closer both to their ancestors and to their concept of religion, which is very different from that of the white men. Okay, so we'll pause at this point in time, part one of this video analysis on the Chief Seattle speech. In part two, we'll go through the remaining part of the text and also discuss the main themes of this particular speech given by the Chief Seattle in 1854. Thank you very much for watching.